When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Good morning, Cockrell. This is Castration of a Cowboy, episode 28 of 45, entitled "A Green Grasshopper Has a Red Asshole." There's a lot into tech this morning, but before we get going, tell them where we are today.
Where are we?
Yeah, where's
Escondido? Escondido 1333 Ben White Boulevard, Austin, Texas.
Do you think they'll sponsor our?
I'm good.
You think we can get them as a sponsor of our podcast? Do you think they'll sponsor our podcast?
No.
I think we'll be here every morning doing our show, radio show. We'll take in callers.
We'll just let the guests come in and
Sit with us, and we'll just take inquiries.
Yeah,
you want no part of that. So,
we have more faith in your technology. Of course, that's what you did for a living. You sold people on technology that generally didn't work with the ship. But, you know, I mean, I understand where you're coming from.
Hey, we're down here in Austin, Texas. We went over to Willie Nelson's house last night.
Had a little potluck dinner.
Yeah, tell them about what a good time we had and the money we raised.
We had a great time and raised a lot of money. We got to listen to Willie play Under the Stars. It was beautiful.
Every song you ever heard him play, it was really good.
And he had some very authentic food. It's called Three Sisters, and they're natives.
You gotta want to eat near the ground.
Uh-huh.
Everything tasted like it's a root.
My hair actually still smells like the like spit fire.
Yeah, I caught the good text this morning.
Yeah,
you want to. Talking through it, but you didn't get to read it.
I didn't read it yet.
Oh,
you have to. I heard that this green grasshopper with a red asshole is actually a song or a chant.
No.
You know, it's up in the morning with the rising sun.
Go ahead.
I don't know, but I've been told the green grasshopper has a red asshole.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
that's a military song.
That's right, marching song.
VMI. Virginia Military.
Anyway, but what was your goal on about the green grasshopper's butthole?
I'm spending more time with myself now than I ever have.
You like yourself?
I do.
Oh, that's nice.
All at once, you know, I find that I enjoy spending time with myself. And, you know, we tend not to do that. And I don't know if it's this orbit. Argovex. I think that's more of it than anything. You know, this high dollar hormone drug that I'm on.
Uh-huh.
And so you have these. When I was a child, I would go with my dad, and he would go down to our ranch, and I would stay in the pickup, and he would park underneath the tree. And I would lay in the pickup, read my funny books, and then I would get out and I would play with grasshoppers.
Oh.
I would mutilate grasshoppers, and I would have war with, and then I would befriend grasshoppers. And at certain times of the year, they congregate on posts. Just as thick as you can imagine, just sitting there, you know, and every once in a while, you know, moving that hind leg, maybe one of them will speak, you know, and then they'll just move in the hot sun on this creosote post.
In unison?
And
just one?
Yeah, more or less. And I got to thinking, we went out to Sam's Town, which is a honky tonk here, and that's the way everybody was inside that bar.
Aww.
You know, for 60 plus years, that just really appealed to me. You know, that was where I wanted to be. I wanted to be on that post.
You wanted to be with the other grasshoppers.
Yeah.
All moving in you.
And now, you know, I don't know if it's just drug. And when I get off this drug, you know, whether I'll go back to running around there with all you old farts and the honky tonks. Or I don't know if I'll say, hey, shit, I had that, you know, been there, done that. It'd be interesting. But I'm good. Good either way.
I like that. The more time you spend with yourself, the more you like yourself, because that could go the other way.
Yeah, that's a new experience.
It could go the other way, where you just are like, I don't really like myself, and now I'm stuck.
Yeah, I think that's when you commit suicide.
Yeah, good. Well, we're happy that's not the case.
Yeah, but
now,
what about the idea that can those grasshoppers survive in solidarity? Can it? Singular grasshopper thrive, or do they have to stay kind of herded up?
I think, you know, they die off in the wintertime pretty well. I mean, some may get in the bark of trees and ride it out, but by the time they come out in the spring, you know, I mean, they're old and decrepit and, you know, been through hell. So I think that may be the, you know, the end of their life celebration. You know, where they get on this post, this creosote post in the middle of summertime and visit.
Thing,
yeah.
Maybe it's like that fundraiser they're having, you know, at the end of life fundraiser. You know, the one at the community center in Dimebox.
Oh, right, yeah. So, you know, when they pull the guy in clippers in a wheelchair because he wants to die with his boots on. You get a pancake for breakfast for $1 and Bob's able to buy. I don't know what the hell they do with that little cool whip full of money, but
I don't know.
Yeah.
But they do that. I think it makes everybody feel better.
It ain't got nothing to do with the sick guy.
I don't think so. Because he's usually really sick.
Yeah.
You know, like he really wants to be home on morphine.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, they drag him out, you know.
They got to take him off the drip.
He looks the worst he's looked in his whole life.
Uh-huh.
He feels terrible, you know. And he has all these people milling around him.
So the other day, yesterday, we had that little chat about how the doctor said, oh, your PSA 7. And then the next paragraph of the conversation said, do you have a will?
Yeah.
You know, do you have your power of attorney? But along those lines, you know, have you written your obituary? Have you scribed
it? I don't think I'm going to do that.
Well, what are people in Dimebox going to read about old Castro after you, like, kick
Tony will write it.
I'm a damn sure write it, but, I mean, you probably want to take first crack at it.
No, I'm good with that.
Oh, you think I can do it?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to start on it today.
Yeah.
I'm going to start on it obituary.
Yeah, I
wrote mine when I was about 25.
Did you think you would say the same things now?
Oh, I was going to can do it. Yeah, I mean, it wasn't even wildly off, you know. I mean, I wanted to be more helpful than hurtful to the world and, you know, try to lift up other people. And so we've done that as best we could.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't get kicked out last night. So we're pretty happy about that.
We got close, but we didn't get kicked out.
Yeah. So what was the setup today at the radiation room?
Mr. Huckabee, Barry Huckabee from Georgia.
Hey, that's a great name.
Who is taking care of his wife who has Alzheimer's. He just celebrated his 50th anniversary and he's lost his wedding band. That he had for 50 years. And he was... He doesn't know when, where, how. He just looked down and his ring is gone. And so, and I asked him, I said, what what did you do when you worked? And he was on a campus crusade.
Oh.
And he would go to different college campuses and coordinate that. And then he worked in construction. And that's what he did. And so we have a him, we have a mechanic, we have a roofer, and then we have a precious little man that just joined us. Just a sweet little 79-year-old man. He comes in with a walking stick, and he went to Walmart and bought him a new little
set of pajamas.
A little workout suit, you know, and brand new.
He can't wait.
And the son brings him in. And
he can't wear a zipper.
He wears a little plastic zipper, you know.
Oh, it's a plastic.
Yeah. And so he just joined us, and he worked at the Heart Hospital in his career. And just a real, you know, sweet. And so they wait for me to get there. They stoically get in the waiting room.
And they just look at the door and wait for you.
And they wait for me to come in there to introduce the subject of the day. And I have no idea what the subject's going to be.
Until you get through that door.
Right.
And today it was.
I don't come in there with any script.
Yeah. Doesn't sing your
song. Just ad lib the whole time.
Yeah, I'm not surprised by that.
No.
Pretty much how you ran your business, too.
Best way to be, I think.
I think so. Very genuine.
Well, what it does is it forces the important stuff to bubble to the top. You know, it gets rid of their bullshit. You know, you go in there, and really what comes out is what everyone in that room needed at that exact place and time. You know, and so they're able to connect, you know, those molecules, that energy. And
like a bunch of grasshoppers.
Some bitch is going to go home and find his wedding ring.
And then I talked to the doctor today. We talked to him every...
Today's Thursday.
Yeah, I talked to him.
Yeah, and what he's... How long? Minute?
No, he had some time, and I asked him, I said, are we doing any good? And he said, well, I'm just looking to make sure, you know, we're not burning the wrong thing.
Like your ball sack.
Yeah. You know, that they're hitting where they want to burn.
How often does he look?
I said, are we burning it? And he said, well, it happens at the very end of the radiation. You know, it's like those cancer cells, they're going there. You know, and they do this.
Finally, they can't get it.
44 times. And then all at once, you're there. And they zap them, and then they fall over dead.
I feel like that's probably what we did in the grasshoppers.
But I think that could be a little bullshit. You know, it don't sound right. I mean, you know, there's nothing in nature that really works that way.
Why would I doubt?
I want them to see. So wait,
I think he got his PhD from Texas A&M in plant husbandry.
No.
Got him an organic radiation license. Now he's blowing your damn gooch up.
No, I think that I want to know, since it gets worse as you go on, do you see him more often as this goes on?
No.
I don't know.
Yeah, he's like hurting a group of 50 men. Okay.
Yeah.
He's hurting them. He's got 50 men at any point in time. In his care.
Yeah. Okay. So with the intellectual elite that
and so
I
those
run with,
huh?
With the intellectual elite that I run with, they call that a tronche.
A what?
A tronche. Well, group, but heard. Just a New England word.
Tronche.
Tronche.
How you spell it?
I'm going to have to Google. Y'all start talking, I'll get back with you. Tronche. But it's just a herd. And then you go, why don't you just say a herd? And then say you can't refer to people like that. But that's all right.
All right.
Go ahead. You digress.
So you use trunk. Nobody knows what the hell you're talking
that's
about.
Right. Yeah, you got one.
And you stay safe.
Yeah, that's right.
But I want if it gets a little dicey at the end with are they going to burn you or not, I want him to, like, really pay close attention at the end.
Yeah, I don't know.
don't know.
You know, like if you're, when you're pregnant, you're just going along and you have one visit every 3 months, and then you have a visit every month. And then by the end, you're going in like 3 times a week till that baby pops out because shit's coming. So I feel like that should be the progression of your doctor visits, because I need him to be looking at that thing all the time.
Yeah, I would think so too.
Yeah. I'm gonna have to get his number. We're gonna have to call in an audible for this one. Excuse me, sir. We gotta run another play. Did you figure it out?
Yeah, I might be embarrassing myself.
Yeah, you probably just pulled it out of your rear.
No, it says
you pulled it out of your gooch.
It says in French, tranche means slice, cutting deeper into the words of etymology. We find that old French word tranche, meaning to cut. Tranche emerged in the English language in the late 19th century to describe a financial appropriation. Today, it's often used specifically of an issue of bonds that is differentiated from other issues such as factors of maturity or return on rate. Another use of the word tranche is in the French phrase une tranche de vie, meaning a cross-section of life.
I understand. I do that all the time. You know, I use words around people, and I just invent these words that sound pretty good for the occasion.
Yeah.
And
they don't fit.
They don't figure it out. You can do that with most people.
If you say it with confidence.
Yeah, if it rolls out and it fits the situation, you know, the phonetics of it.
It makes them,
you know, they're impressed. They think, man, he's smart. He's intelligent. I bet he has an IQ of 140.
You read a lot. You read a lot. You know, you're a big consumer of the
words.
Words. I find that people that work with us who have British accents, they come from the UK or, you know, over there in London and whatnot, they can pull that stunt better than anybody. Like, you hear somebody say a word, you have no idea what it is, out of a British accent, you just sit there and go,
okay.
Now, I mean, they could be saying poop in a pot for all I know, but it just sounds so sophisticated. I think you're pulling that same little thing down here.
I think that you just did.
Yeah. Yeah. It's okay too.
Yeah.
I mean, unless you get it around somebody who's smarter than you.
And then you're
going to think back to
then you best keep your mouth shut. But, you know, if you're dealing with nincompoops, which most of the people I deal with are
nincompoops,
you know, I get by with it. Uh-huh. They never catch it.
Yeah. My dad used to use big words a lot. And he would just say them like with confidence, like he knew what he was saying. And you'd all just go, okay. I mean, and then you'd go back and look at them and be like, yeah, that didn't even work. That is not what that word means. I do that to you often.
I'll take it.
Yeah, you'll say something and I'm like, hold on, what is
Trons.
That mean?
Trons.
Not hurting the meat.
That's got to be a PCG word.
That's right. That's exactly what I heard. I don't mean to be, you know, the thing is, I don't mean to be pejorative, but I'm going to now proceed to be pejorative. You know, there you go. You have to listen to that kind of bullshit.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a mess.
No. So you never told us actually what the doctor said. Like, he didn't say thumbs up, thumbs down. I know what his job is, but you didn't tell us if he said you're doing bad or good.
It's all numbers, okay? I mean, he has you up there and he's going in and out and you know, when you get there in the morning, they're gearing up, they're testing the radiation machine. You know, it's all mathematics. We have, as a society, moved away from faith, you know, to numbers. And we have recognized that this metaphysical world is not really where we need to be. We need to be over here with computer chips and mathematical formulas. And that is the key that we needed to unlock. So, you know, that's totally where we're at.
Yeah.
The book we read, and I won't quote it this morning, but it's called One Truth. This fellow, Daryl Hobson, was making the point. Religion and science have the same exact characteristic. Is at first you kind of get it, right? The Ten Commandments. But then you kind of go deeper into it. And then what about can you be gay or not? And what can you have an abortion? You know, you get deeper into it, it gets foggier and foggier. Well, science is the same way. These simple numbers start out, but you get deeper and deeper into artificial intelligence, you know, machine learning, and it starts getting just as goofy. You know, you, the things that you're certain about become less certain as you get deeper into your journey, whether it be religious or scientific. But, you know, it's just another form of, damn, I hope it works.
Yeah. And I have a, you know, I'm sure Dr. Claire Johnny, he sees his 50 men that he's in charge of now as nincompoops. You know, we haven't gone through years and years of training. We do not have his mind. You know, we're not anywhere near his level in this area, okay? And so, you know, I think that the men are comfortable with that. He's comfortable with that.
He's basically saying big words confidently, and y'all are going, yeah.
Yeah.
But he doesn't say 7 of your 12 sectors, 6 of them we've got under control. We got this one last one up here in the northwest corner that needs an extra double zap.
They defer everything. You know, this is slow moving. We will not know how we're doing until 4 months down the road, okay? And I really can't tell you now anything other than we're not burning your asshole. No, we're succeeding, you know? We're hitting it with all this juice, and we're controlling it. And then, of course, you know, he always asks, do you have any birdie?
Vibrating?
In your asshole.
You know, up your anus or, you know, in your pecker. Is anything burning?
Anywhere.
Yeah, and you say, no. He's, you know.
We're not killing him.
This is good. I'm on. We're doing it. We're doing it, you know. We want to burn everything.
Yeah, but now what's
except
that?
Except your penis and your balls and your asshole, you know.
Yeah, but what?
And then we hope for the best.
Yeah, but what about the fact that we're in now, well over halfway, and you don't have a, you know, you're not sticking with the propaganda. You're not on the literature. You know, you're defying. Maybe they're not giving you enough of the good stuff. Maybe they need to turn the butane up on this thing.
We're not trying to burn it.
Well, he said he was supposed to get.
But maybe the burning means that.
They
don't want the burning.
Or vibrating.
Yeah, I wouldn't want that.
Yeah, we tell people about their little test quiz. We say, yeah, and every morning let's take a quiz, and they ask him, is your butthole vibrating? And it stumps everybody. They literally go like, a butthole can vibrate? You know, I mean, I just get some. And so we I don't know. We hadn't heard anybody that says, oh, yeah, I have
made. Yeah, I know that feeling.
Yeah.
See, by the time you get into radiation, you have been so humiliated. You know, you have been.
You had to do the dead cockroach.
Beyond anything you've ever experienced in your life, you know, you have been humiliated.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there's not much fight left.
You just roll over.
Yeah.
You just take the punches.
Yeah. Go ahead and burn it.
Okay. So are your boobies any bigger? Or are they about the same?
I don't know. What do you think?
They're nice. I mean, I guarantee you.
Yeah, kind of wants to touch them.
Yeah, if you walk down the street in Key West with your shirt off, they might give you a ticket.
Very good.
Hey, we're right in the middle of the show. You say hi to all our friends. Hey, that was delicious. Thank you very much. Please.
Sure, thanks.
They got a nipple law in Key West.
You have to wear a pasty.
You got to put a pasty on. And so what we do is get you a couple of them Texas Longhorn pasties. And stick them right there, and it'll look like it's charging down the street at you as you walk down the street to Duval Street.
Yeah, that's why I'm going to lose some weight.
Yeah.
Hopefully I'll lose them in my boobies.
Yeah, but the question is, do they take you off the juice so that you can get back your maidenhood? Are you done? You're a bra wearer.
That'll be interesting. It'll be interesting to say. I know it doesn't. You know, Mary is going to the honky-tonks. By herself now.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Now she great.
Yeah.
She's out. She's looking around for a replacement player.
No, she's. You know, I think she's played out. You know, she wouldn't want anything to do. But, you know, she goes out, and then all the little old women, you know, ask her how I'm doing, you know. But I have no interest at all of going there and sitting on the bar stool and talking with them, because, you know, it's just doesn't interest me anymore for some reason.
Yeah. Saturday night, we go in the Continental Club.
How long are you going to be down?
Sunday.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Or we go to the Wild Horse.
Yeah, we'll set up.
Where is it you go? I wouldn't say Continental Club was.
I thought it was Broken Spoke.
Nah, let me get Mark, my brother-in-law. We'll figure something.
You know, this is South by Southwest weekend.
I understand.
Yeah.
But he's the guru of that.
Yeah. So you've been taking it in music?
No.
Yeah, because we were here the podcast about music is healing.
Yeah, the healing power. It was Mozart, the healing power of music.
What I do is I have AirPods, and, you know, I get on Pandora at Gold's Gym, and I just let it rip. I dance. I move. You know, I mean.
But Jeff, take
I mean, care. Just completely, I don't give a shit what anybody thinks, you know, and I do my steps. You know, I do my routine for like 30 minutes, maybe 45 minutes, and I'm good.
Yeah, so you have to take your hearing aids out.
AirPods, the music is better.
Better quality. And, you know, you got that up to, after your quadruple bypass surgery, you got up to, what, 3 hours a day working out?
Yeah.
And now you're down to 30 minutes?
Yeah.
That's just been that much of a pull down.
Yeah.
I like you're still going. And if I was at Gold's Gym and I knew that every day you came in and on the treadmill you danced, I would figure out your schedule and I would come and I would be on the treadmill next to you just to enjoy
it. And then she'd ask you for one of your AirPods.
Yeah, because I would want to dance along. That would be amazing.
Oh, that's good. Hey, Kotra, I left the book I was going to read you today, the little quote, but it's in the door. We're not going to get there.
No.
We're too hemmed in here.
How'd you get here?
Daniel's truck. And, but it was the book I wrote, you know, Farmer Lloyd and Granny's Big Farm in the Mountain. And on the back page were 10 life wisdom quotes or guidelines to live by, you know, and I get down to number 9, and they used to tell me, and I wrote it in the book, wasn't sure what it was at the time, and then would like your insight. Number 9 tidbit for advice from Grand Lloyd was always leave room to turn around at the end of the road. What was he talking about? What did that mean? You know, because we plowed with a horse, right? So you always, when you made your field, you always had to leave enough room. So you didn't take your field
all
the way to the fence post. You gave yourself enough room so you could get that horse around and get to the next one. But I'm sure that he meant it more, you know, prophetically than just leave.
It's always easier to curve than it is to back up. If you back up, you got to pull, and you know, I mean, it's a pain in the rear. But if you curve and you know you're going to have to change directions, then it's a lot easier.
Yeah, you don't want to pin yourself in. I like that.
But you know, he had a seventh grade education. You know, he grew up raising chickens. He helped pave the real road there. He was there, worked at the factory, you know, making parachute yarn. What was he saying? I mean, he repeated it hundreds of times in hundreds of different situations, not literally just setting up the beef bag, and I mean, I think I know what it means to me, but I like your assessment there. Number 7 was never travel out of town overnight without your own car, which is pretty much what you did last time. You said I ain't got my own car. I ain't going. I think that was a bit more practical.
Well. There's a life lesson.
Yeah, that's good.
All right, maybe, you got, if you, if you didn't have your own car, then you get pinned in and you can't take the curb. Now you got to back out.
Right, sorry. Hitting with the
MDX.
All right, mind, body, soul.
Oh, yeah, I'm just going down.
But I really don't think the viewers, it really is a more, so I thought it would do that. I thought you'd go, and then we call it dive and driving as a pilot. You come down and then you ride it out. This has really been a pretty
slow,
linear digression.
Yeah, and I think it's, you know, it's just the way I mentally deal, like when I had bypass surgery or when I had, you know, I severed my quadriceps or I had a colon resection. I just envision, you know, how long it's going to take to mend myself.
Uh-huh.
And that's a real personal decision.
Right.
You know.
I agree.
And then you figure that out. And then you do it, but you give yourself enough time at each phase. And so at this phase, I thought, well, you know, if I do 30 minutes a day, that's enough. Kick back, you know, just progress slowly. You know, this whole prostate thing is a slow deal. So, you know, you can't get in there and hurry it up, you know. It just don't work. You know, nobody's going to get in a hurry about this thing.
Yeah.
You know, Fitbit, you familiar with Fitbit?
It's the like a step. It's like a little step counter.
Thing you put on your wrist and it keeps track of your steps and how much you move. I never used it, but I understand it.
Yeah.
Well, there's a whole competitive product called Whoop, WHOOP, and it doesn't really care so much about what you do working out. What it cares about is how good is the quality of your rest, you know, letting your body recharge and you know, feel refreshed.
Yeah, just recover from.
Because if you were doing 2 hours a day still, you'd be beating yourself down when your body really needs, you know, just quiet time, you know, time to rejuvenate.
Yeah, I think that radiation stresses your body.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, it's that I'm burning more energy. I'm burning more calories. You know, everything is dealing with that. So, you know, right now I'm doing the right thing. I'm just doing what I feel comfortable with.
Yeah.
30 minutes a day, it's good.
Yeah. Okay.
I think you're doing the right thing too.
Yeah, but that was the answer on your mind, and I think that's true.
And his body.
Yeah, yeah. Do we really cover those in two? Is your mind and your body kind of just on the same slide?
I think they're all merging into the same.
Yeah.
I think they do, because I think if, you know, as long as you can kind of keep good spirits and keep your mind from getting down into a hole, because if your mind gets down in that hole, it's going to pull everything down with it. And so it seems like if you can kind of get your mind right while you're doing this and just be patient and kind of move with it, your body will do the same and your soul will do the same. And
the mind's the only thing you got control of.
Yeah, I was the other day.
The other stuff comes along with it.
The other day, I was a little worried about you, you know, the real challenge, you know, and to me, it was kind of like one of those big, long races. You hit these rough patches, and you just got to, calm yourself, you got to let yourself just settle down, and then get back into the groove.
Yep.
And you did that, I felt like, you
know, beautifully,
the next day, you had a tough, and I thought, oh, here we go, but now, and then, you know, you've recovered, so that's good. All right, what else we got to cover? That's it?
That's it.
Good.
Yeah, good. Hey, folks, this has been Castration of a Cowboy, episode 28 of 45.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, entitled Green Grasshopper Has a Red Asshole. Kotcha, we love you. It's good to see
bye-bye.
You.
No, listen, thank you for letting us have breakfast with you.
We appreciate you, and we're proud
Levels.
Of you.
Levels.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yes, good. Hey, and listen.
Ranchero.
This episode has been brought to you by
Escadita.
Sea Ranches. A for-profit corporation certified by the state of Texas in Dimebox, Texas.
Dimebox.